Some of the most interesting voices from overseas reach us, from Greece to Israel, Syria and Zimbabwe, Germany, France, Poland, Algeria, and in particular from Italy. Among these voices is Amara Lakhous with his two Roman novels, Clash of Civilization over an elevator in Piazza Vittorio, and Divorce Islamic Style, and his two, more recent, Turin novels, Dispute over a Very Italian Piglet, and the forthcoming in English, The Hustle of the Little Virgin of Ormea Street. If there is one thing that all of his novels remind us of, it is that we are all immigrants somewhere, within the borders of the country we live in or outside of it, and that there is much to be gained from understanding, in Edward Said's words, that survival is about the connections between things. It's to Amara's wonderful and inexhaustible goodwill to keep forging these connections that we owe this visit today. We hope it's only the first of his many to Cornell. And we also owe it to the Cornell Institute for European Studies and its Mediterranean Studies Initiative, Gail Holst-Warhaft, Chris Way, Jason Hecht, and the staff in Cornell Institute for European Studies. Marta Letao is here. Much goodwill and immense help came from Laura Brown and Michael Bush in the Office of the Vice Provost for Undergraduate Education and from the Mario Einaudi Center for International Studies. We are also grateful to the Departments of Near Eastern Studies and Roman Studies for their support. Saha, and thank you very much for being here, everybody.
People. Thank you for coming. When my publisher, Michael Reynolds, said to me that my book, Clash of Civilization, was chosen by Cornell University, I was really very, very happy, and it was a big, big surprise for me. So I would like to thank Professor Laura Brown and Gail and my friend Cora. I moved to the United States 3 months ago. This is my third immigration or third birth. I was born the first time in Algeria in 1970. I left my native country in 1995, and I was born for the second time in Italy. Every immigration is a birth, and every birth is an immigration. When I immigrated the first time from the belly of my mother to the world, I caused her a lot of trouble. Instead of coming out with my head first, like my five sisters and three brothers, I decided to come out with my feet. The risk of dying was real for both my mother and me. My mother still remembers this enormous pain. Why did I do this? I probably wanted to walk quickly, to move in order to discover the world. This birth perfectly reflects my destiny, my entire life. In 1995, in the middle of civil war, I escaped Algeria. My work as journalist on the radio was sufficient to be blacklisted. Many friends and colleagues were assassinated. In Italy, I found a new opportunity to live, study, write, and dream. I lived in Italy for the next 18 years, first as political refugee, then as an immigrant. In June 2008, I became an Italian citizen. It was a long adventure, but full of rich experiences. During these years, I personally experienced the burden and challenge of immigration. This new condition pushed me to continually ask myself, how can I reconcile my culture of origin with the new cultures? Anthropologists use the concept of acculturation to explain the permeability of cultures. When two cultures meet, they undergo a reciprocal influence. They give up the ineffective, old elements and they acquire new, more functional ones. I tried to take in the best of Algerian culture and Italian culture. My father was an immigrant in France during the 50s and the 60s, and early 60s. It would be accurate to refer to this time in his life as being in exile rather than being an immigrant. Because during the Algerian War of Independence from 1945 to 1962, he could not return to his homeland. For 7 years, he had no way of speaking to his family. Upon his return to Algeria after independence, he discovered he had a daughter who had grown up in his absence. And he had never even seen a photo of her or heard her voice. Fortunately, my immigration experience today is drastically different from my father's. I call my mother on my mobile phone whenever I want, and thanks to Skype, I speak to my sisters and brothers almost every day. I can share emails, text messages, photos, and videos with relatives and friends all over the world. I am able, as are most immigrants, to maintain a close relationship with my homeland. Actually, I don't know what is my homeland, Algeria or Italy. This is another question. So immigration has lost its dramatic connotation as path of non-return. In this sense, I belong to a new generation of immigrants. Abdel Malek Sayad, an important sociologist of immigration, he is Algerian, and he was one of the most collaborator of Pierre Bourdieu, one of the most important sociologists. Sayed studied the kind of immigration that now belongs to the past, that of my father's generation, with all its wounds, tears, distances, long absence, insults, and suffering. His book, La Double Absence, has been translated into English under the title The Suffering of Immigrants, because the book is really about suffering of immigrants. The double absence means an immigrant is absent from both his country of origin and from the new country. And now I feel present in many places. So I am present in the United States because I live in New York. And I am present in Algeria because I always read Algerian newspapers every day. I am present in Italy because I am in contact with my friends, my Italian friends. For me, immigration is a positive experience because it gave me a lot of gifts. Nevertheless, exile, because you know, exile is the most and the hardest experience of immigration. And the difference between immigrant and refugee, that immigrant can come back in his country and the exile or refugee not. So I know very well this issue. But for me, the immigration is really a positive experience. Today, I'd like to talk about two gifts, imagination and language. The first gift, immigration as a source of imagination. In my novel, A Dispute Over a Very Italian Piglet, there is a description or exploration of a Moroccan boy's imagination. Actually, it's my imagination as a child. Samir, the name of the character, began dreaming of Europe as a child because it was very close to his native city in northern Morocco. It took only a few minutes to cross the Straits of Gibraltar. In fact, the distance that separates Africa from Europe is just a few kilometers, To be precise, only 14 fucking kilometers. He dreamed a lot as a child. He believed that on the other side, there were only blonde, blue-eyed children with straight hair. Their parents showered them with gifts, with chocolate and candy every day, because they were very rich, unlike his parents, who always had trouble making it to the end of the month. In childhood, he developed a strong feeling of injustice. He said to himself, "My God, why didn't you bring me into the world 14 kilometers to the north? What did I do wrong?" He was always told it's a matter of maktub, destiny. Everything is decided before you are born, so you should always be satisfied. God has his blessed reasons and never makes a mistake. End of the quote. For me, immigration was a big source of inspiration and imagination during my childhood. I remember that every summer the immigrants came from vacation in the village of my parents in the mountains. I noticed that the children and the women changed clothes every day. And I conclude that they didn't wash their clothes like we did. So I was convinced that they lived in paradise in this country of where they live in immigration, where everything was possible and every dream was reality. There is a very nice story that I like to tell here. It's about green cheese. I have 5 sisters and 3 brothers, and I am the 6th. My mother has never said who is her favorite daughter or son. She is very diplomatic, my mother. She always swears to God by saying, "I love my children in the same way. There is no difference between them." My father was completely different. He always declared openly that I was his favorite. When I was a child, he decided, because he is the authority, he is the big boss, so when I was a child, he decided to give me the privilege of having a brioche every morning. And he used to buy cheese just for me. Amara's brioche became the evidence that I was the spoiled boy in a poor family, because really we were poor. I started. What is the reason? The secret of this big love, my father. It's language. I started speaking Berber, my mother tongue, fluently very early, and I became a phenomenon in my neighborhood and in my big family. My father was fascinated by me. One day I said to my father, "I am sick of this cheese." He said, "What do you want?" I said, "I want green cheese." So my mother said, "Cheese is always white." So I said, "Green cheese exists, I am sure." My parents, my sisters, and my brothers didn't forget this story, and they used to make fun of me for it. Someone, just to tease me, started to call me Amara Green Cheese. In Arabic, we usually say to somebody who wants to impossible, "What do you want? Bird's milk?" But you know that the birds don't have milk. This is Arabic. So, but for my family, green cheese was the proof that I was very spoiled and I was a strange dreamer. 30 years later, I got my revenge. In 2000, I spent a few weeks in Bristol, England. One day, I went to the supermarket. I saw a big department with different kinds of cheese. And I found my green cheese, made with apple skin. I was very happy and excited. I called my parents, my sisters, and my brothers, and I said to them, I was right, green cheese exists. The story is not finished. Just 2 weeks ago, I discovered cheese with pesto. And obviously the color is green. Imagination is very important in my life, and it's related to immigration. The British writer Colin Wilson says, imagination should be used not to escape reality, but to create it. I agree with him. I am a big dreamer, and I can't live without imagination. The main character of my novel, Divorce Islamic Style, Sophia, says, what meanings is there to life if you don't have dreams? No, having a dream to fulfill is the best reason for living. There are people who consider life a real curse, not a gift from God. What shame, because in spite of everything, life is beautiful. The second gift, immigration between languages. And this is actually the most important thing of my literary project, language, immigration between languages. In Clash of Civilization over an elevator in Piazza Vittorio, the main character Amedeo says, so many people consider their work a daily punishment, whereas I love my work as a translator. Translation is a journey over a sea from the shore to shore to other. Sometimes I think of myself as a smuggler. I cross the frontiers of language with my booty of words, ideas, images, and metaphors. I am poet here, just here in this passage. I have always been fascinated by linguistic mediators, such interpreters and translators. Personally, I live between many languages, Berber, Arabic, Italian, French, English. I write in Arabic and Italian. I can say that I am a linguistic polygamist. You know, I am Muslim, so I can use just metaphor here. I am a linguistic polygamist. Actually, my wife likes this metaphor. My literary goal is to Arabize Italian and Italianize Arabic, mutually contaminating my many languages through literature. I wrote my first novel, A Very Tiny Pirate, in Arabic in Algeria in 1993. I failed to publish it due to censorship. When I escaped Algeria in 1995, I carried it with me. In 1999, I published this novel with my own money in two versions. It was a crazy project, really. I spent all my money, but I'm very happy for this. I'm very happy. One in Arabic and one in the Italian translation, both in one volume. You know, in Arabic we write from right to left, so two books together. It's actually two books that meet in the middle. Two texts and languages that embrace each other. This is actually the sign of destiny. It's like metaphor of my writing, because I'm bilingual writer in Arabic and Italian. And in that book, the last page of Arabic and the last page in Italian meet together. They are together. It's wonderful. And in that time, I didn't decide to be a bilingual writer. It's like maktub, destiny. The translation was done of my first novel by a young Italian translator named Francesco Leggio. It became my best friend. In this translation project, I played the role of the assistant or consultant. I remember the long discussions, arguments, and compromises. For example, Francesco translated the Arabic proverb "Rabbiyat al-haml ma andush sinin." Arab here? I mean, nobody here? No Arabic? Just one. Okay. This is an Algerian dialect actually. Rabbi ya'ti al-hamli ma andu sinin. God gives meat to those without teeth. Into, this is translation of Francisco, God gives bread to those without teeth. He told me that Italians use the same proverb, but that instead of meat, it contained the image of bread. My question was, why not did a new version of this proverb into the Italian language? The most interesting translation problem was the burden of religion in the text. You know, translation or maybe writing in two or three or many languages is like a mirror. You can see the language in other side. Actually, I didn't think about this issue, the role of religion in our life in Algerian and Arabic and Muslim societies. So the most interesting translation problem was the burden of religion in the text. In the Arabic version, there are many references to religion. For example, Astaghfirullah, God forgive me, Allahu Akbar, God is great, Inshallah, God willing, etc. The translator told me that my characters sounded like priests, because it suggests, but you know, in the daily life, it's normal in Algeria, Assalamu alaikum, Inshallah, etc. So in Algeria and in Arab countries, it's normal to continuously use God's name in daily speech. We need to decide whether to leave this or cut it out. We argued a lot about this. At the end of the translation process, we asked ourselves, who does this translated novel belong to? The author or the translator? It's true that the author gave birth to the novel, but the translator raised it like one raises a child. When it comes to the relationship between the author and the translator, I often think of the Caucasian Shock Circle, a play by the German playwright Bertolt Brecht. The play is a parable about Grosha, a peasant girl who rescues a baby and becomes its mother. The biological mother wants to have her son back. Who will get the child in the end? The judge decided to apply the test of the chalk circle. The child is placed in the center of circle, and the two mothers must pull the child toward their own side. The true mother in the end is the one who refuses to do harm to her child in this way. After this experience, I decided to no longer have my novels translated, but to rewrite them in Italian myself. So I became a bilingual writer. Clash of Civilizations over an elevator in Piazza Vittorio is my second novel. The original title in Arabic was How to be Briefsted by a She-Wolf Without Being Beaten. In the Arabic version, the most important character of the novel was Rum, the She-Wolf. In the Italian text, on the other hand, another poetic and political need came forth. After September 11th, there was much debate over the supposed clash of civilizations. But in a way that was truly trivial, in this clash of civilizations, the norm was obviously the West, and the Muslim world was certainly the other. And if civilization means culture, poetry, music, science, I never heard a clash between Italian and American poets, clash between Canadian and Egyptian musicians. So the clash is over oil and, you know the story. Then I thought that if everyone was speaking of clash of civilizations, I could do it too, but involving an elevator. The elevator is effectively a metaphor for public space with where it is hard to reach compromises. The elevator is the center of microcosm of ethnicities and cultures, but also the cause of tensions and disputes, as well as the site of the assassination of Lorenzo Manfredini, alias Gladiator, in the novel. Switching from Arabic to Italian is really writing rather than translating. It is free from the constraints that a translator must inevitably submit to. I had the opportunity to cut, add, edit, and update the text to my liking. Therefore, the text in Italian is not a translation. At most, it is a betrayal of the original. In Italian, we say traduttore, traditore, translator, traitor. I wanted to betray the original text. I always use the word rewriting. The mission of a good writer, in my opinion, is to write and rewrite, betraying the original version. The title of Clash of Civilization over an Elevator comes also from my great passion for cinema, especially the Italian cinema. The Commedia all'Italiana, the Italian comedy, taught me to look at contradictions, which make it clear that reality is not black or white, but black and white at the same time. In Italy, there are many social contradictions, like in Algeria. I work in two languages, Italian and Arabic. According to my friends, especially in the beginning, this kind of work will lead nowhere, because a writer is like an artisan who must specialize, choose a language, and only work in that language. I think it is more interesting to move in two layers. For me, basically, it is a way to try to be original. For this reason, I do not have many role models from which to draw. In Italy, there are writers who come from a different cultural and geographic context and begin to write in Italian, but nobody else uses this bilingual method, because each novel has two versions, one in Arabic and one in Italian, like twins. My style, whether in Arabic or in Italian, is always the same. Firstly, to ensure simplicity, I use the first person. For the same purpose, I use colloquial speech to keep strong grip on reality. I use a lot of dialects too. For example, in Divorce Islamic Style, in Italian version, I worked on Sicilian dialect. In Arabic version, I worked on Egyptian, Tunisian, and Moroccan and Algerian dialects, especially in the dialogues. This was born out of my need to write in a very simple way. I also like to write this way. The fact of not being Italianissimo, actually is the title of my dispute, Contesa per un maialino Italianissimo a San Salvario, dispute over a very Italian piglet, very Italian, not just Italian. So in Italian we have Italian and Italianissimo. So just say, I think it's a particularity of the Italian language, grandissimo, bellissimo. I remember, it's a good memory. So I worked for many years in Italy with refugees. I remember, I wrote my clash of, my novel thanks to this experience, because I lived with Iranians, Kurdish, Iraqi, Pakistani. So for me, it was really a big source to write this book. I remember a young Iranian refugee. So one day he said to me, "Today I met," so in Italian, "oggi ho incontrato una ragazza molto bellissima." Molto bellissima. So I said to him, you know, in Italian you can't use molto, very, and very beautiful. He said to me, I know, but believe me, this girl is molto bellissima. But I think it's a new way to change Italian language, molto bellissima, because you know rules is not really definitive. We can change the rules and we can change language too. So the fact of not being Italianissimo, very Italian, 100% Italian, makes me live in a condition of vulnerability, sometimes inability. But I think it's really a big advantage, because the most problem for us is certainty. When we are convinced and certain about some things, and this is the way to be extremists. So you have just one truth and this is finished. Instead, when you have doubts, that means you are open. Sometimes I am wrong. I have doubts. When I wrote Clash of Civilization of an Elevator and Divorce Islamic Style, I never used a dictionary. I don't use words just to make an effect on the reader. I write in simple way also because I consider myself a teenager in Italian language. I had lived in Italy for 10 years when I wrote Clash of Civilization over an Elevator in Piazza Vittorio. So I was really a teenager, child, 10 years, child, yeah. Divorce Islamic Style is my third novel. I wrote the first version in Italian, and afterwards I started to work on a new version in Arabic and Italian at the same time. I went crazy. I would change the keyboard from Arabic to Italian and the other way around. Each language and text improves the other. Eventually, the two were born as fraternal twins with different titles, covers, characters, character names. In 2012, I moved to Turin in northern Italy to write my new novel that takes place in San Salvario, a multi-ethnic district located near the central train station. It's true. I moved to Turin to live with my characters and to live in that neighborhood. This is, believe me, this is the truth. Turin has been in a transitional phase for many years. In the past, it was a destination for Italian migrants from the south. And recently, it has become a city of new immigrants that come from all over the world. In this current literary phase, I have begun to experiment with new contexts and have taken the perspective of a southern Italian man as my main character to understand the issues surrounding the old and the new immigration in Italy. In 2 years, I wrote two novels, A Dispute Over a Very Italian Piglet, published in English this year, and The Hustle of the Little Virgin, which came out last month in Italy, and it will be published in English next year, inshallah, God willing. In conclusion, it's customary in Algeria to call the maternal aunt the mother. So I have one biological mother and two aunts' mothers. In the same way, I have Berber, Arabic, and Italian, maybe English, as mother tongues. A language is like mother. She loves you because you are her son or daughter. To learn a language, you don't need visas, or to immigrate between languages. You don't need visas, passports, residence permits, green cards, or citizenships. It all depends on your will and your freedom. In fact, language is freedom. Language is different than nationalism and religion. For example, you can't be Muslim and Christian, Jew and Buddhist, Protestant and Hindu at the same time. It's impossible. You have to choose one. Even with citizenship, I am lucky because I have a dual Algerian and Italian nationality. Some other countries force their citizens to choose only one. In language, there is more democracy, more freedom, more love. You can speak Italian, Arabic, Spanish, Turkish at the same time. Living among languages is great advantage. In order to explain it, I remember a phrase of Federico Fellini, the great Italian filmmaker. Every language looks at the world in a different way. Ogni linguaggio guarda il mondo in un modo diverso. I try to look at the world with my mother's languages, Berber, Arabic, French, Italian, and English. Thanks to them, I can have different keys for opening many doors. That means bringing metaphors, imagery, idioms, proverbs, memories from one language to other. I like the metaphor of the bridge builder a lot. Do you know what my name Amara means? Builder. Means a builder. So I am builder of languages, of stories, of cultures. I consider myself a mediator of cultures, and especially a mediator of languages. When I was a child, I hated one question. Who do you love more, your mom or your dad? What a cruel and stupid question. And you know, I was really smart when I was a child, very smart. So I refused to choose. My answer was, I love my mom, my dad, my grandma, my grandpa, my aunts, my uncles. So speaking about identities, cultures, languages, we can live simultaneously in many cultures like me. I am Berber, Arab, Italian, and will soon become American. Do you know what my new dream is? I'd like to add English as my third language of writing. This is my personal version of American dream. Thank you.
Actually, my translator, Anne, is really, I think, one of the most important translators from Italian into English. So she asked me maybe a few things. I remember the Neapolitan. There is a few words in Neapolitan in the novel, and she asked me ahead, but the rest she... I think she did really a wonderful translation.
Do you feel like, my question was to finish, did you feel like you learned a lot in that process about the English language by having somebody sort of introduce you maybe to new idioms or new metaphors?
Yes, of course, yes, of course. You know, my wife is American, so so I have this, because you know, language is intimacy. People ask me, especially in France and in Algeria, why did you choose Italian rather French? So I always answer that you need intimacy. You need to live really very close to language. And I have this feeling with Italian because I lived in Italy and I love Italy. So maybe in English in few years. But I start now to understand a lot of things, especially idioms and jokes. Because in idioms and jokes, you have to understand the context. It's not enough to know the meanings of the words, but you know, you have to understand the context. I'm so interested in this.
I wonder if you could say a little bit about what you have found most interesting in the reaction to the book, The Clash of Civilizations.
Where? In Italy or everywhere?
Yeah.
Well, in Italy, when the book came out, was really a big surprise for all, including me. But I think that the success, because I had really a big success, and it was adaptation of in cinema from the book, from the novel. I think there are different reasons for this good audience, not just in Italy, and the book was translated into Japanese, for example. I think there are different reasons. The first reason is this: I understood that it was very important to give voice to many characters, because you know the world, the reality is very, very complex, and you know we have just two eyes, and the reality is very complex, so we need a lot of eyes. So eyes here, to look this reality, because it's very complex. And in this novel, there are different voices, and between Italians too, because you know the professor from Milan and the concierge from Naples, there are two words different world in Italy. This is the south and the north. So it was very interesting to understand the complexity of this reality, thanks to these voices. This is the first choice. Mm-hmm. The second choice that I made, Italian comedy, because Italian comedy, it's a comedy style. You know, in general, when people talk about immigration, tears. Crying and dramatic, so I did a different choice. So I choose comedy because I think irony, humor, comedy are more effective to convince, to involve people, to involve readers. So the audience actually was really very, very good. And the novel, this is very interesting. So I wrote this novel in Arabic, and they published it in Algeria and in Lebanon. Then I wrote off the novel in Italian. So there is a French publisher, Actes Sud, one of the most interesting, important publishers in French, translated the book from Italian to French. So there is an Algerian publisher, Barzakh. So he published the book in Algeria. So my novel was born in Arabic and grow up in Italian, then come back in Algeria. And this is really a wonderful thing, because we have this this conflict with friends. This is like love and hate in the same time. So for me, Italy is like the door. It's like the bridge. And my novels, I have three novels published in French, and my publisher in Algeria published this novel. I actually dispute over the Italian piglet came out 2 weeks ago in Algeria. So Italy for me is like a bridge to come back in Algeria. Thank you.
I've read the book, but I haven't seen a movie. I saw the trailer for the movie. In the trailer for the movie, it looks so dark, where the book is really comical and anything like that. So could you tell us a little bit about the movie? Because the trailer that I saw, it didn't really look like a reflection of the book.
Yes. I have a copy of the movie. It's in English subtitles, so if you want a copy, no problem. I can send you. It's very different. It's very different because you know the you are right. The movie is dramatic. It's not a comedy. This is the first. And the second problem of the movie that in my novel, I try to give voice to Italians and to immigrants. But in the movie, the perspective is just Italian. And actually maybe they gave more importance, because there is a dog in the novel, they gave more importance to Valentino than the other immigrants. You know, this is the reality. In Italy, unfortunately, immigrants don't have any importance. They can't vote. This is a very important issue. They can't vote. And their sons, if your parents are immigrants and you are born in Italy, when you are 18 years old, you have to ask permanent resident, because you can't become automatically citizen. And you know, for applying for citizen, you have to have a lot of documents. I have the experience there. So the movie is different. Unfortunately, I didn't participate in the screenplay and the other in the movie, in the other three characters, new characters. So of course the story couldn't be the same. So because if you add the three characters and the main characters, yeah, it's. But anyway, I am really so happy for this, because the movie gave a new audience for the book, and for me it was a big dream, because I have a big relationship with cinema, especially Italian cinema, and it was a good thing for me.
It was hard for you to choose the murder in the book. In the sense that you were probably to choose none of the immigrants and not to use the stereotype of always the immigrants are the robbers or the murderers, and choose the Italian person for the murder. Or how was that for you to choose this?
You know, this is a very important question. You know, I use the spy or thriller plot in my novels in a different way. So in my case, and there are, my model is an Italian writer, Leonardo Sciascia. So in the classical thriller or spy story, especially in the thriller, so you have the murder and assassination, and you know the writer gives the readers information, and the readers participate in the request, in the investigation. So in my case, in my novels, actually this is not priority. It's just I use this just to involve readers, and in the, for example, in Sciascia, Leonardo Sciascia, the responsibility of the murder is not enough, because you know in his novels, Leonardo Sciascia is one of the most important Italian writers. He's Sicilian, and he wrote a lot of novels about mafia. So in his novels, the murder wasn't one man, one person, because the responsibility is collective, it's the society, it's the culture. So in my novels, the murderer is not really very important, and the most important thing is to narrate the reality, the society and to give voices, to give voice to many persons.
Why, my question is related to hers. Why do you choose that like a black novel genre, like crime story? Because it's so typical your novel of like if you read Agatha Christie compared to, it's sort of a very, I don't know, I wonder why that genre?
Yeah.
Yours, it's sort of more deeper into other society issues.
Yeah, so we are talking about the style. So I actually try to mix thriller and spy story because in divorce Islamic style it is a spy story. It's about terrorism. But so I try to mix a comedy and thriller. This is, but I think most important aspect in my novels is comedy, not thriller or. Again, I used the thriller aspect just to involve, because I believe that readers are more very active in the process of writing, imagination, and so this is just trick. Yes.
Did you say you're living in New York City?
Yes, I do.
How has your immigrant experience been to America versus when you first went to Italy?
So I moved 3 months ago to New York, just 3 months. So I think it's really wonderful. Wonderful city, and it's a good location for in the future. I mean, so the now I have really in my talk I said this is my third immigration, my third birth. So now I am baby 3 months, because I'm studying English and I'm trying to reflect to dream in English. I think that United States is a big laboratory of cultures. This is very important. And in New York, especially in New York, you can't feel immigrant. And nobody asks me where are you from. So we are all immigrants and we are all New Yorkers, and I like this. I like this so much. And so the reality is really very very interesting for me as a writer.
I'll ask you again when you're a teenager.
Yes, yes. Or maybe child, because baby.
Yes,
you
have a question.
Yeah, in your novel, you touch on a lot of powerful themes.
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
Yeah, so in your novel, you touch on a lot of powerful themes, including identity and language, but the idea of public spaces that I find really interesting. So what's your personal experience with public space and why you chose for it to be one of the focuses of your novel? And how has it changed between different cultures, Italian culture, Algerian culture, yeah, American culture?
Yeah, I think that public space is very important in each democracy. Because you know, we can say we are for freedom, but if people we are with freedom, but people can live their freedom just at home, not outside. This is a problem, for example, in France with the virus, the foulard. So Muslim, you can pray at home, not go to the university with virus. I think this is a big problem, and a big problem. And I choose the elevator as metaphor because it's very important space. Because people meet in the elevator, and maybe they have the opportunity to exchange some words. And I remember I have really a very interesting memory. So I worked for many years in Italy in a center for refugees and immigrants in the big building in Rome. So there's our neighbor in the second in the first floor, and he was so he was very critic with us because he thought that the center for immigrants and refugees in the building, there are a lot of families, is a danger. It's a big danger. One day I entered in the elevator, and he never said to me something or hi, buongiorno, buonasera. So one day I entered in the elevator. I had a German dictionary in my head. So he saw the dictionary in the elevator. He saw the dictionary. He said, "Ah, do you speak German?" I said, "No, unfortunately, I'm trying to study." He said, "You know, I speak German." And a few days later, he invited me to his apartment to show me his books in German. And when I entered, I found the monument of Mussolini. he had a big monument of Mussolini as a fascist. But, you know, thanks to elevator, this space, because for the first time, we were very close. We were very, very close. And for me, it was really a big opportunity in the public space, including elevators, to exchange. Because, you know, without dialogue, no relationship, no communication, just stereotypes and bad things.
Well, I think we'd better you'd like to join us.
Yes.
So, those of you who would like to join us for a more informal question session and for some wine and food. We are having a reception in the AB White House, and you're all welcome to join us.
Thank you again.
Thank you so much.